So this morning I'm going to start a three-week series that me and Pastor Jaco and Theo Potgieter will preach. Theo, I hope your sermon is already prepared and in your heart that it's growing in stature. So we're excited. We're going to preach a three-week series on loyalty. Just, I believe early in the year as we come together as a church, that we will root it, that we will be rooted, that we will be planted. Bernard, when I look at you, I can't help to think of the article in the Republican. Thanks for being such a good ambassador for our town and our nation. It's nice to have you also here in church. May we all be ambassadors for Christ, the way Bernard talked about our beautiful town and tourism industry and everything. Bernard, I guess you're on the spot right now, okay? So you're lucky that it's your birthday today. Is it your birthday today? No, it's not your birthday. No, sorry. Okay, nevertheless, I'm going to start the series, and the first part I'm going to talk a little bit is something very exciting, something you never or very seldomly hear in church about, and that's church membership. Okay, so firsthand, to give me a scripture where you find be part of a church, and it says church membership. Can you give me that scripture? First, Carol, why are you shaking your head? Don't you believe in that? Where does it stand? Then I'm teasing, I know. It's nice to know who's on your side. Church membership, where does it stand in Scripture? Do we find it there? I believe it. Thing is, there's no Scripture in Romans or Corinthians that says, thou shalt be a church member. But I believe it's biblically implied. Where do you find the Scripture that mentions the word Trinity? You won't see that explicitly, that using that word. But I believe that most of us, and hopefully all of us, will believe in the Trinity, in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, because it's biblically implied. So this morning, I wanna share and start this sermon series on loyalty and commitment with other pastors. We'll continue, and we're going to talk a little bit about marriage, in a sense. And that's where we're going to talk about church membership. In our third year Bible school, there's a familiar slide that some of the students will remember. Aaron John will put it up there. And where we talk about form and function of church. We were just worshiping this morning. Worship is a function of church, but it can have different forms in many church. You can have more drums and electric guitars. You can have almost none of that. But worship is a function. The way we do it can differ in many churches. Okay? But there we have divine ownership, the characteristics of a local church. We say one of them are divine ownership, there's godly leadership, committed church membership, regular fellowship, biblical discipleship or ministry, and financial stewardship. Those are all elements of a biblical church. So we don't have a specific scripture that says thou shalt be a member of the church, but it's something that we really believe is biblically implied, as I said. Now, this morning, I'm going to make a distinction between the universal church and the local church. So, I'll say this morning that there's a distinction between members of the universal church, people who are members, who belong to that church, who makes me and the brother in India or in Angola or Zimbabwe, that makes us brothers in Christ. And for those of you who have traveled and maybe went on missions or just traveled for the fun of it and got to another nation and spoke to a spirit-filled Christian, what a joy it is when you can rarely understand someone's language, but you can attend a church service or a small group and you can fellowship together and you just have this feeling in your heart, the Spirit saying, this is someone who's serving the same God, someone who's got the same values, the same spirit inside. What a joy that is. But I'm going to, let me say, when in Acts chapter 4, of Acts chapter 9, verse 4, we see that Saul was persecuting the church. We all know they were really afraid of him. And then the Lord Jesus spoke to him and he said, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? So Jesus is very clear. There's no massive distinction between Jesus Christ and his church. We can't separate the two. And from time to time, you will get to a situation where there's someone out there who wants to have this relationship and all these revelations between that person and Christ, but I don't want to be part of the church. And that is simply contrary to the New Testament. We can't say, Jesus, I want you, but I don't want your church. Now, as you sit here this morning, some of you come for 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, maybe more years with church. And I believe we all have different feelings about church and seasons in church where you loved it and maybe there were tough times. I have learned so much in my life in church. I remember I made a massive mistake once in Windhoek while I was the pastor there in one of our churches. I had a good friend in church. We were really good friends, and the guy, I felt a typical Namibian, a guy with a, no, I can't say typical Namibian, and then I say he's got a thick skin. That's going to sound very rude. That's not my heart. But he was one of those guys, he's not easily fazed in a sense. And I walked into the church early morning, and the band, the worship team, he was leading the worship, and he always called me Pastoorkie. He's a lot bigger than I am, so I guess that was fine. I never objected to that. And he made a joke with me, and I made one back. And then he said something, and I said something back. And then about 30 minutes later, when church had to start, I was looking for the worship leader, and he was gone. I asked the band, but where's this guy? No, he got in his car and he's left. I said, what? Did he buy Coke or something? No, the one lady told me. He looked a bit offended. I'm like, what happened? No, he didn't say. Got on my phone. Yes, Hannes, where are you? No, I don't want to talk to you. I'm like, what do you mean you don't want to talk to me? You must lead the worship right now. What happened? But what I didn't know, I saw him as a friend, and we made a joke or two, which I thought is quite okay. But there was a pain that I didn't know of in his life, and I stepped on that toe. And that was so bad to him, something I didn't know of, that made him got in his car and drove off. So someone else was in the hot seat and had to lead worship because I definitely can't do that. And afterwards, I said, we had a coffee or two, and I said to him, well, I don't understand. Please tell me what happened, because you know me. My intention was definitely not to harm you or to be rude in any sense. And then he told me a story what happened, and something that I said jokingly, because he made the first joke, you know, was really painful to him. Was something he held an offense with. And then I said, man, please forgive me. I honestly didn't know, and he forgave me because he knew. But for him, it was so personal and so still raw in a sense. And the thing is, we sit here this morning. I don't know what your past life in church has been like. Maybe there was idiots like me who offended you in a sense. Not meaning, you know, not something you wanted to do, but it just happened. And I've seen it in small groups, someone just not coming to small group anymore. And then you follow up on that person and he or she says, no, but this person said this or that and I can't take it. That's. And then you're just like, okay, well, now we have to work on this. So church, I just want to say this morning, we come from a lot of different places, and maybe you are very careful to come too close to the church, especially in terms of membership, because of a past experience. And I trust that if there is kneeling that need to happen, that God will do that. We all need it. I've been offended in church many times, I promise you. But we need to work through those things, because we can't say we want Jesus and then we don't want the church. It doesn't work like that. We say yes to Christ. So basically, when we talk about the universal church and who's a member and who's not, I want to read you something. It says, the members of the church are those who have made a commitment to the church by making a commitment to Christ. And that speaks of salvation. Basically, the first few verses of John chapter 3. And I remember, I think I've told the story before, last year, me and Pastor Mac, one of our pastors, they were here for a marriage enrichment course. I took him back to the airport in Walvis Bay having coffee. And then there was a lady, and you know, he's an amazing evangelist, Pastor Mac. He started talking to the lady and basically evangelizing there, telling her about Christ. And he said, so are you a child of Christ or a child of God? And then, you know, she said to him, but we are all children of God. Now, the thing is just, none of us are born Christians. There's a place in our lives when we say yes to Christ. And we become members of the universal church when we say yes to Christ. Then we get membership, if I can use that language, of the universal church. And that is when you go on holiday, fly to India or China or America, and there's a believer, and hopefully they use God's name not in vain, and you can That's the way, you know, not probably where you will hear someone is not a believer if they use God's name in vain, especially if you go to America. No offense if there's any people from the United States in church. But the thing is, that's that connection. That's that same blood that we have. We read in Acts chapter 2, verse 46 to 47, "And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added their number day by day, those who were being saved." Okay, that's the early church. That's the part of where church was born, in a sense. And it says the people that were saved, they were added to the church. They were the members of the universal church. Now, allow me, please, 5 minutes where I just take a little detour this morning, where I talk about salvation this morning. Something that it's not something, it's not a valley. I would say it's a Mount Everest in theology. Something so special. And I believe every one of us who made that commitment to Christ and got in the water and were baptized, we will say, God has changed my life. And because we have salvation and we've got a new heart that God put in us, we must have that heart for everyone around us. That must motivate us. That must inspire us to pray for our town, our neighbors, our families, our children. We must pray for that salvation. Say, Lord God, please save them. I just want to talk about regeneration this morning. It says, it's a secret act of God in which he imparts new spiritual life to us. That's the language we use, being born again. Okay? That's where we, basically, that core disposition that we have, God comes and he put in a new heart. You will remember that early days of your salvation. Maybe it's a long while ago, I don't know, when you just felt like everything is new. That thing where your brother or sister, like I, in my own experience, I think you are mad because you're now praying and listening to gospel music and you don't wear certain clothes anymore. That beautiful place of just want to be with Christ. I remember going to a first year's camp and, you know, we had to fast and I'm like, I can't fast, I'll die. But I just had this willingness in my heart because in the flesh I would say I will never do it. But when Christ comes in, everything changes. Conversion. Conversion is our willing response to the gospel call in which we sincerely repent of our sins and place our trust in Christ for salvation. Regeneration and conversion are so close many times. The first one, God comes and he regenerates us so that we can say yes. Okay? So that we can, through the process of conversion, say, Lord, I repent for a lifetime, whether it's 10 or 60 years of sin, of being disobedient. Lord, I see what Jesus Christ has done on the cross. Please save me. And that's what Christ will do. Whoever calls on the name of Jesus will be saved. People, that's the steps. That's the way. That's what we proclaim as a church. And that's the steps. That's the entrance to membership of the universal church, where someone walks in through that door and you can say, we are brothers and sisters in Christ. As a church, we're not just a group of people with good morals who wants to keep Swakopmund clean and hopefully there's no theft and broken marriages and stuff. No, we're a Christian church. And that says, if you are a member of the church, it comes through salvation. It points everything to Jesus Christ. And that might be seen as a dividing line, but it's no small thing to become a Christian, to become a child of God. Knowing not just everyone, children of God. It comes through new birth. So that is basically just a little bit about the universal church, and most of my time this morning, except my tithe at the end, which I will explain. I want to focus on the local church. So scripture talks here and it says in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17, a well-known scripture, it says, obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls as those who will have to give an account. And that's a scripture, when I read it, I always almost get, not chicken pox, hoenderfleis, nah? Where I always think, God, you're going to keep me accountable. You're going to keep at least you're going to have Mark and Vander sitting next to me in the hard chairs, and we're all going to be kept accountable. If you're a small group facilitator, a ministry leader, wherever you are in leadership, there will be a measure of accountability. God will ask us one day, why did you feed the sheep? Did you look after them? Now, here's the thing. If you're visiting here this morning, if you are maybe just here in town, you're still on holiday, then you're really blessed and very lucky, I guess. But you see, if your local church is in Windhoek or Walvis Bay or Chumip in the north, or maybe another nation, you're most welcome. Friend, brother and sister, it's awesome to have you here. But you see, I'm not your father in that sense. I'm not your leader. I don't know what's happening in your life. You see, you've got a local pastor somewhere who's walking a road with you, where that discipleship will happen and where there will be accountability. So if there's, I said at the start, church membership are biblically implied. If there were no scripture like Hebrews 13, I guess you can just be part of whatever you want to and come and go. But you see, there's accountability. God is going to ask the leaders of the church one day, listen, give an account of your sheep. So the leader needs to know who are in the fold and who's not. Now that doesn't sound very like fun, maybe from a Western perspective, maybe 2017, where we all want to, you know, me and my life and I make my own decisions type of mentality. But you see, it's a biblical command. It's a biblical command for Christians. For Christians. Okay? So that's the place. I'm also in authority because I'm under authority. I'm not just standing here. I've got senior leaders up the food chain, if I can put it that way. You see? And it's very tough sometimes, especially when you think you're starting to do things right in life. When someone is walking to you and say, listen, let's have a coffee. Let's have a talk about this or that. Because especially as men, I guess, we have a natural bit of pride. I can see there's people confessing, going like this, so I'm not the only one. But you see, when there's healthy accountability, someone can ask you, listen, friend, I've been to your house. What is wrong? The way you speak to your wife, there's something wrong. You see, so there's a relationship, just as Scripture says, listen, wives, you must submit to your own husbands. Okay? And the husbands must love their wives as Jesus loved the church. Hallelujah. I don't have to love all women the way I love Jesus. One is enough. I love my own wife. Okay? You see, they need to submit to their own husbands. There's that personal relationship. There's that covenant. And the same thing goes in church. When you say yes, when you make a commitment in church, and you say, I want to be a member of this church. I want to grow here. I want to be planted. I want to be taken care of. Then there's this accountability where we can talk to each other and we can say, listen, let's speak the truth in love. Let's talk about, let's sit down and maybe you want advice, maybe you want to ask something, etc. But if you don't know who's part of the church and who's not, then we've got a problem. Because how do we define the relationship? And I want to say, whenever in life, when there's commitment in a relationship, then there's a platform for growth. That goes with our children, goes in marriage, it goes with our friends, people we spend time with, people that we walk a road with, especially in discipleship. Then there's a place where we can grow. But if it's just this happy-go-lucky, do whatever we want to, you know, then there's not a lot of time for sitting down and looking each other in the eyes. So I really believe that command is important. You know, when we make a commitment to a local church, it's a rational decision. It's something where I say, listen, I've prayed about it, I thought about it, I visited the church. And here I want to use a picture. I remember when I was a student there in Stellenbosch and I got born again and I started to go to church really as a new believer. I got at the end of 2002, I gave my life to the Lord. And then start of the new year, I started to attend Bible school. And I remember how glad I was when I started to attend Bible school. And I saw there was a lot of beautiful girls, like my wife, doing Bible school as well. Because walking on a campus town like Stellenbosch, there's a lot of good-looking ladies. And you might think I'm talking about weird stuff, but that's biblical, that I guess we're attracted to each other. Okay, you will find that in Scripture. There's books dedicated to that. But nevertheless, you see, now I distract myself. I think of my wife. But, you know, then you spot someone like my wife, but she wasn't my wife yet. And now you get an excuse to sit next to her, or and then after a while you think, well, she's biblical. Well, now she's a Christian. Vanner, don't laugh at me now. And then there's that place where you want to get to know that lady better. And, you know, eventually you get to a place where you want to put a ring on her finger and say, listen, I've prayed about it. I've spoken to a few good friends who know me and who know her. I want to get engaged. And then after that, there's a place where we get married and we say, listen, in good and through bad times, for better and for worse, where you go, I will go. And we make that covenant. We get married and we invite our friends and family and the pastor is there. And we say, listen, we've tied the knot. Now it's for life. And people, there's this place where some of us might be at different places where you maybe have seen the church, the lady, and you think, well, she looks nice and I want to get to know her better. Good enough. That's a fine place to be. But there's a place where we can progress and we can say, listen, I want to get engaged to this church. I really want to take a step forward, maybe have a coffee with a pastor or a small group facilitator and understand more about their vision, more what they believe in. What is this new birth and stuff you're talking about? Please explain it to me. And we say, yes, you're welcome. Please come closer. And then there's a place where we can say, listen, I want to marry. I want to put my name on paper. I want to make a commitment. Now, let me say something very important, because we come from different backgrounds, maybe churches even, and that is, I remember in our old, one of our pastors, senior pastors said, you know, when you need to move on, maybe your work sends you to another town and it's time to move on, we will never be able to release you because we're never going to bound you. We're not going to put a chain around your hands or ankles in that sense. Okay, when you like Dolph and Nita and you need to go back to the farm, then Gruno, we say, Dolph, come and stand here. Let us pray for you. Let us send you. May God bless you where you go. We're not going to bound someone in terms of church membership in an unhealthy way. Okay, when there's a time and a season and everyone agrees and you maybe need to move to another church, we will release you. We will bless you in that sense. Okay, when you need to travel, maybe move to other country or job for whatever reason, God has got a different season for you, we will say, God bless you. Please go to a church and we can even help you to find a good church or at least a similar type of church. If you don't know that town, if you haven't been there before, we can phone a pastor or two and say, listen, please look out for, who will I say, Mark, are you to be sent soon? Please look out for Mark and his wife. We are sending there. Please receive them. Please take care. Look after them. They are good people. Maybe some little bit difficult sometimes. They've got a dog and children and stuff like that. But make them feel welcome. And then we can send it. And then there's another place as well, where I guess many of us have been married for a long time. And then the marriage grow through a tough season. I guess many of us have been through seasons like that. And then it's a time where we can say, I'm still married to you, church, but I want to renew my vows. I want to make a commitment again. I want to make a fresh commitment and say, listen, not because it's about the church in the sense of the pastor or the name or the vision. Jesus, we're talking about in the bigger context of loyalty here. I want to come closer to you, so I want to come closer to the church. And you know what, young people, you can ask all the married people who will tell you the truth. I believe they will tell you the truth. That when we get married and we get closer to each other, we discover a few weaknesses. We discover a few sins, maybe even. We discover difficult things about each other, in terms of personalities, the way we do stuff, that we need to work through that. There's a lot of grace for that. But when you come closer to the church, there might even be something like between me and that worship leader friend of mine. I phoned him the other day and they're doing fine. There's no bad blood in any sense. But you see, coming close and saying, I'll put my name on the line. I want to be part of what you do here. That might be challenging. It might not always be a walk in the park. It might be challenging. But there's a few reasons, and I don't want to try and prove a point in terms of biblical church membership. I believe it's biblically implied. We can talk for hours on that. I'm just going to touch a few things here. I believe that in a town, in a society, when we say to ourselves, the Lord is leading me to a church and I want to commit there, I want to be a member, then we make a visible commitment to that church and to Christianity. Because when you stand at the bank and there's a queue of people and you talk to someone and you get to a Christianity, and you talk to each other, maybe which church you belong to, where do you fellowship, I can say, I'm part of Shofar Christian Church, Swakopmund. That's my house. That's my family. And someone will know what that church hopefully stands for. And then we can say on a universal church basis, hey man, praise God, we are family. You serve at the other family than I do, but we're family, okay? But you're a member there, you submit under a pastor and the elders and the leadership, and you in the same sense. So if we would take a child that is born, a child of the human race, okay, that baby will be a human. So that makes it part of the universal church or humanity. But that child will also be born to a father and a mother. And that father, and it takes a father and a mother to have a baby, a married husband and wife. And there will be a husband and wife who will take care of that child. That will be the local church. That will be the place where a new believer comes into and that it can have a healthy place to grow. I believe also that in a low commitment culture, our culture is a lot about me and where I go and I'm a self-made man. And, there's a lot in our Western mindset many times where we want to decide and we want to call the shots. But when we make a commitment and I say, I'm part of that church, I'm a member of the church, it says, listen, I'm becoming part of something bigger. I'm submitting myself to leadership, something many of us don't like that much to bow the knee. But it's something that God does in our hearts. I believe after new birth, it's so much easier to say, church leadership, I will submit to you. I want to become part of something. So it also goes against our independent culture where it's me and I and myself. That's something that's so terrible in many ways in our society today. It gives us that place of saying, I'm part of something bigger. I'm part of a vision. I'm part of the global church through the local church as well. The thing is also, when I look at God, when we page through the pages of Scripture and we look at the character of God, and I'm saying this with a lot of respect, that God isn't a happy-go-lucky God. He's not there the one day and the other days there somewhere minding his own business. God and his people, God is so much more committed to us than we can ever be to him. God is so much more loyal and faithful, looking after us. None of us can protect ourselves or keep ourselves alive when we're sleeping, okay? But God says his hand is over us. God doesn't slumber nor does he sleep, okay? So when I look at Noah and Abraham and Moses and David and the new covenant, or I look at marriage, I see a pattern and I see a God who loves commitment. I see a God who says, I will be your God and you will be my people. Okay. And I see a God who keeps his leaders accountable. I see a God who asks questions. I see a God who wants to know about stewardship. Let's think about the talents. God has given us certain talents. What do you do about it? How do you go around with that? So I see a God who wear commitment. God doesn't just say, listen, you go take another wife every 5 years and just have as many children as you want to. No, God says, listen, you get married to that lady and that covenant will last a lifetime. It's not like, okay, so that is important. That is something that is part of God's character. That is something that's part of who God is. When you take that step closer to church and you say, I want to become a member, I also want to read Ephesians 5 verse 21. It says, submit yourselves to one another in the fear of the Lord. And I believe, church, we can talk about this a lot more at other places. But you see, when you take that step closer to the church and you literally want to get married by making a commitment, I believe there's also that place, and it's part of our membership, where we say, listen, you can have an expectation that it should be instruction, that there will be leadership, that there will be safety, that the word of God will be preached, that all those functions of a biblical church will function, that we will have worship and that we will have intercession. Fortunately, some of the elders sitting here this morning, and many times on Thursday mornings, not the Tuesday intercession that everyone have, on Thursday mornings, 5:45, we come together and we talk about the church. We pray for the church. We are concerned about certain things happening or people. And there's a place where we can follow up and say, listen, how is it going with that person? I heard through someone that person is sick or ill or under pressure, or maybe the relationship are a bit tough. And we can follow up. We can pray and we can bring people before God. And I can honestly say we do that. Okay? We really try our best. We will pray. I believe there's protection, there's devotion, there's reception. And I want to say from where I stand, yes, church is difficult sometimes, and sometimes we have to humble ourselves, to look someone else in the eye and say, I will walk a road with you. Maybe you're in a small group and there's something has happened before, but there's grace for those things. We can grow past those things. We can forgive. And as the proverb goes, you know, iron sharpens iron. Sometimes we God place us in this relationships where we can grow in our godliness, where we can grow in the fear of the Lord and in the fruit of the Holy Spirit. So earlier on, I said I'll be a biblical Christian and I'll tithe on my sermon. That means I've got a brother there in America that's also a pastor, and he's part of the Universal Church, Pastor John Piper. And I just while I'm doing research and reading on the topic, I came across one of his, 4-minute video clip that I really want to show you. And he just nails it so beautifully there. And he's, whenever I look at him, he's almost like this father figure, this grandfather. And I just want you guys to hear his heart. So I'm going to dedicate or tithe 4 minutes of my sermon to him. And I want us to listen to what he has got to say. While we are listening to that, or maybe Edward, you guys can start. We said we are busy with a loyalty series. There's a card that we're going to hand out this morning that we please want back. And you can say on that, basically, if you want to know more about the church, or if you want to know more about the ministries, or if you want to know more about who we are and what we do, or church membership, please give us a call. Please give us an indication that we can follow up on you. Because as I spoke earlier on, maybe you are at that place of dating. Maybe you are at that place where you want to take a step closer and get engaged, or eventually where you want to marry and you want to say, listen, I want to make this rational commitment. I want to say yes, and I want to be part of what you as a church are doing. So I just want to say, you know, it's still early in the year. It's still starting, you know, the year still fresh in many ways. And I believe we've got all things in our hearts what we want to say to God. God, you need to give me the grace this year for accomplishing things in your kingdom. And there's one promise, there's many promises in Scripture. But one is when God says, you know, when we draw close to Him, He will draw close to us. That's a promise that God gives us. And whenever we want to run after God, whenever we want to pursue God and relationship with Jesus Christ and want to be used in His kingdom, I believe there's no way that we can go to that place without straight going through the local church and saying, Lord Jesus, I want you, but I want your church as well. So I just want to encourage us here at the start of the year to reflect. I know many people, maybe you're a loyal, committed member, and maybe you just want to say this morning, listen, I want to renew my vows. In my heart, maybe to your small group leader or a zone coach or someone, a leader that's maybe you're part of the hospitality team, or maybe you're part of the worship team, and you want to say, listen, man or friend, maybe we had words last year, but I want to just say I'm committed. I'm committed to this ministry. I'm committed to this church. If God leads you in that sense, you will know where you stand if you want to know something more about it. Because I know whenever I can speak to my father in the natural, I say, Dad, I love you and thank you for everything you've done for me and instructing me in life. I know there's something beautiful happening. I know when I say to my wife and I can look her in the eyes and say, listen, we're going to make this work. Or this year we're going to spend good time together. Or there's a commitment level. I know then covenant is cut. There's a place where we come closer to each other. So I believe we want to hold out this hand this year. And even if you want to differ, you're welcome to come and have a coffee. We will not yet apply church discipline in any sense. But please, this is an invitation. And as I said, and as Pastor John said, I believe it's something that's biblically implied. So that's a safe place. That's a good place to be. So no matter where you stand, maybe renewing the vows or making that first step, taking it something closer, growing in your relationship with Christ, I wanna hold a hand from our side. We will always welcome. We will always nourish. And I believe it's a safe place for us to be here at the start of the year, to think about it, to pray about it, and then to take the appropriate steps. Let us pray together. Father God, we want to thank you this morning, Lord, that we can see, Lord God, that you are so much more committed to us than we are to you, Lord God. Father, we fall short and we sin, Lord God, and we get things wrong, Lord God. But you never turn your back on us. You don't just walk away. Father, thank you, Lord, that you don't just love a few blue-eyed people, Lord God, but that you love all of us, Lord. Lord, that your heart's desire is for all man to be saved, Lord God, and to come to the knowledge of Christ, Lord God. And Father, we see in Scripture, Lord God, that the first step to become a member of the universal church is through salvation, Lord God, about being born again, Father. And Father, I pray that that might burn in our hearts this year. Father, salvation for Namibia, Lord God, that it will be something that we will pray about, intercede, Lord, and that we will act, Lord God, we will act on that, and we will preach the good news, Lord God, that it will be on our lips all the time, Lord God, and that we can rejoice, just like I believe in heaven, it's rejoicing, Lord God, whenever someone is saying yes to Jesus Christ, Lord God. Thank you for changing that core disposition that we have, giving us a new heart, a new mind. Thank you for renewing us, Lord God. And Father, there's an invitation, I believe, Lord God, for us to commit to a local church. Lord, to say, I'm part of this church. I want to commit to the leadership, Lord. I want to be planted and I want to grow here, Lord God. And Father, I pray for those who have been hurt or offended, Lord God. Father, whether it was unintentionally or not, Lord God, I want to pray that you'll bring healing in our hearts, Lord. Whether it's in marriages, where there's a covenant as well, or maybe in this place where we can shake hands and say, yes, I make a commitment to this church, Lord God. I will put my name in the line. Father, let us walk away from that place of saying, Lord, I just want to have elbow space, as Pastor John said, and I want to call the shots and want to be my own church in many ways. Father, bind our hearts together, that we can have a common goal, Father God, that we can reach the lost, Lord God, in this nation, in this church, Lord, that we can make disciples and raise leaders, Lord God, and that we can plant churches. Father, we know that the harvest is there, Lord God, and that it's plentiful. Father, we pray, Lord God, that as a church, Lord, we will be prophetically obedient to where you lead us this year. Father, we want to proclaim and say a big yes to where you lead us. We want to say yes to what you say in Scripture. Lord, we want to be biblical Christians, Lord God. And Father, we want to be it with joyful hearts. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks for listening to this message. If you've got any questions or if you would like to get to know us better, please contact us. The details will appear below. I want to also encourage you to listen to some of our other video material. The details will be on the screen. If you're in the surroundings and you want to come and visit us, you're most welcome. We would love to get to know you better.